Hi, I'm Nicole from AWS.
And I'm James from Slalom, and this is My Architecture.
So you've modernized the way that you deliver campaign reporting using machine learning for your customers. Can you tell me a little bit about how you got here?
Absolutely. So I work for Slalom Consulting. We're a big AWS partner, including AI and Machine Learning Partner of the Year when we were doing this project. Our client was a small nonprofit with a big impact. They try to guide regulation as it becomes law. So for instance, when Congress passes a law, it lacks specificity to turn it into a regulation. An agency then needs to write those rules. Mm-hmm. Our client tries to guide that rulemaking to make sure that it's an effective law. While that's happening, there's a 90-day comment period where anyone can go in and write comments in regulations.gov about how they feel about the law. We gave them a capability to pull those comments, apply machine learning and AI, so that they can, for the first time, ingest 250,000 comments in that 90-day period, gain insights, and then dynamically run their campaign.
I gotta ask, typically, how many comments are typically put against one of these policies?
It's a great question. So sometimes thousands on a really controversial topic, it could be 250,000 or 500,000.
Wow.
Comments.
Wow, when you're working at that scale, considering there's millions of constituents and thousands of government employees, finding ways to scale that is paramount. So turning our attention to the architecture, how do you ingest data into this platform, into the solution?
Yeah, so all the data resides in regulations.gov. And we set up a daily ingestion using a Lambda function that runs every morning. We pull in all the new comments, and then we drop those directly into S3.
Okay, so S3 is your data store. Now, is this an event-driven architecture? As soon as files drop in, what do you do with it? How are you actually gaining insights into that data?
That's right. So we use Sagemaker notebooks. The clients were really familiar with writing Python in notebooks, and so that was most of our architecture. We would pull the comments out of S3, clean the data, taking out things like special characters, and then changing markdown text into plain text. And then pre-process the data so that it's in the right shape so that a variety of machine learning models can then take the data and then create the results. And then once the data is clean, we drop a CSV file back into S3.
Okay, so now we've got our data staged for the next step of this process. Can you tell me how you're using these machine learning services to actually do something with that data?
Absolutely. The first step is to understand whether the author supported or opposed the comment, and then we do a lot of other analysis. So first, we use one of the Hugging Face open source models called FLAN, UL2. This is a relatively lightweight generative AI model that can really quickly judge sentiment, and this is a form of sentiment analysis. So first of all, we used FLAN to decide whether or not this was a supporter or an opposition. And then we actually had some validation in the background to make sure that this was an effective model at doing that. We found that it was more than 99% accurate.
Now, we're doing sentiment analysis, and we know in the age of bots, it is kind of tough sometimes to find whether or not every comment is actually, well, useful. How were you defining or whether or not it's a bot that sent that comment?
Great question. First of all, regulations.gov filters a lot of bot comments out. Mm-hmm. So most of the comments that we dealt with were actual people writing comments in regulations.gov. Second, we need to understand, is this a form letter, for instance? And we need to count those, but that's not necessarily the most important voice that we want. And so we were able to use functions within scikit-learn to cluster some of those comments together and understand some body of them were written by form letters or written from form letters that were adapted.
And I do see that you have a mixture of Bedrock and SageMaker in here. Can you tell me what led to that decision-making process between using SageMaker for training your model or Bedrock?
Great question. One of the things that we used Titan for was for expert designation. We want to read through the comment and understand, is this someone who has a degree in the topic? Hmm. Or is this just someone who's kind of angry about the topic, and that's good to count, but it's not the one that we want to highlight for our clients. Titan is really good at understanding complexity of language and understanding whether the person was an expert. Mm-hmm. We also used functions within scikit-learn to understand grade level, another way to filter experts so that we could highlight the right comments. In general, we wanted to set up a low-cost AI solution. Mm-hmm. So we used scikit-learn where it was possible. That's really low cost. We used a lightweight AI model to do a lot of the sentiment analysis. Again, that doesn't cost a whole lot. And we reserve some of the more complex, tough questions for Titan, which is really effective at that.
And I'm curious about the skill sets of your team then. Did they already have the skill sets to support leveraging Sagemaker?
Oh, it's a great question. So first of all, on the client side, we had a couple of developers who were really good at Python. They knew notebooks well. We used a lot of the tools that were in their ecosystem. On our team, we had a very skilled machine learning engineer mm-hmm. who led a lot of the technical development. But this was last year when a lot of people were learning generative AI. Mm-hmm. And so we brought in a couple of junior ML engineers, and they learned along the way too. So this was a relatively lightweight team, and we were able to get this done in about 8 weeks.
Wow, that's actually rather quick. So now let's talk about how your customers are consuming this data. How do you actually make this data available to them?
Yeah, so all of the results from these models go back to S3. We drop it into the CSV format because mm-hmm. that's what our clients were using for additional analysis. And then from here, they use Tableau for reporting. So we gave them a daily refreshed dashboard where instead of dropping everything they're doing and reading comments all day long during the 90-day period, mm-hmm. they can come in first thing in the morning, see some of the changes in the campaign, and then make their decisions based on that.
Very good. Now, one last thing I want to know then is how did this accelerated process for reading through these comments kind of impact your customers? What was it like before and how are they able to leverage this now?
This is one of those examples where AI makes something possible that it just simply wasn't possible before. So a small nonprofit cannot get to 250,000 comments and gain those kinds of insights in a 90-day period. Now they're able to process a lot of comments, grab the themes, understand some of the experts who are weighing in on the campaign, and then use that every day to guide their messaging. So this is a new capability that just wasn't possible before these AI tools.
All right, good. Well, James, thank you so much for sharing your GenAI architecture with us.